Hi, and welcome to Answers News for January the 11th. I got the date right.
You got the date right.
January 11th, 2018. And so Ken is not with us today. So he's got some medical appointments that he's dealing with. And so we have Avery Foley back again. She was on a couple weeks ago, filling in for us. And she's a writer and a speaker here at Answers in Genesis. Mm-hmm. And so we're glad to have her back. And now the women
outnumber
have the majority.
What's up with that?
For the first time in a year of Answers News.
I knew this. And so, you know, on this particular event, I decided I would bring some woman distractant. You know, so I'm getting ganged up on here, I've got chocolates over here. that usually works pretty well.
Sadly, that will work effectively.
It will.
We got to have some
very, very true. So if you're watching on Facebook, just make sure you let us send those emojis across, because you know how Ken is.
Yep. And he said he was going to be watching. So
I know he is.
Well,
so,
he better be sending emojis. We're going to have to check this.
He better be.
Yeah. Okay. And tell us where you're from. We've already got people here from, New York City. My daughter's on, which is good. Ohio, all kinds of things. We're kind of gearing up here for a major, supposedly major winter snowstorm. We'll see if it actually happens.
You never know about that in this part of the world.
I know. I had a friend who posted something on Facebook today, and it said, snow accumulation, 0 to 100 inches. So basically, we have no clue. We could get a lot, we could get a little bit, but we'll see what happens here.
Yeah.
So. All right, well, we're going to go ahead and get started. Looks like a lot of people are getting on, and so continue to tell us where you're from. So the first article up is, largest group of Mennonite churches leaves denomination. So this is about the Lancaster Mennonite Conference, which is one of the largest Mennonite congregations in the U.S. And there's been, obviously, just like in many church denominations today, a lot of disagreement over the issue of sexuality and LGBT type issues.
Yeah, there's about 179 churches involved in this particular split, saying, "Hey, we're gonna jump out of this," and they're leaving because there are people within that larger denomination, that larger umbrella organization, that are open to homosexual marriage and things like that. Mm-hmm. And this particular group said, "No, we're gonna stick with what God has to say in His Word, and we're backing off from you then."
Yeah.
And you know what? We want to encourage that, believe it or not. We want people to stand on the authority of the Bible from the first verse. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean, you know what? We're going to follow a lot of the Bible, but you know, when it comes to these, we're just going to throw those out and go with the world. That's not the way to do it.
Right, yeah.
And we're just going to see more and more of this. I mean, isn't going to stop. We tend to think of Mennonites as a more conservative denomination, and even they're struggling with this particular issue.
Yeah, I mean, you see this type of infiltration, and that's the right word for it. You know, people are infiltrating the church, teaching some of these false doctrines. The Bible says there's going to be false teachers that are going to introduce destructive heresies. This is exactly what we're seeing. I mean, the Bible is very clear, 1 Corinthians 6:9, 1 Timothy 1:10. When it comes to homosexual behavior, I mean, this is a sin. The Bible is clear about that. When sexual immorality starts to just explode within churches, you know, what are you going to do? You got to go back to the Word of God.
Yeah. Looks like we have several Canadians on here.
I see that.
So Avery is from Canada.
I am.
They said it's cold there, and then I saw someone else said they're joining from Hawaii.
Oh,
hey, there we go.
Lucky them.
Or it's nice and warm. All right. Playboy might kill magazine to focus on World of Playboy. All right. So for a few
sounds
years,
like good news.
New. So for a few years, the magazine's been kind of in trouble, and some people might think, well, that's a good thing if subscriptions are falling and they're not, you know, having a lot of people want to subscribe to it. The thing we need to realize is the reason it's falling is because internet pornography is so prevalent and easy to access. They don't need them, sadly, they don't need the magazine anymore.
And that's really what it is. It's just a shift of avenues in different places. Mm-hmm. But what they're wanting to do, they're like, well, you know, why are we wasting this focus on the magazine, which is really going in the wrong direction for them from a business standpoint.
Right.
Instead, they want to put their claws into a whole bunch of other stuff. So they're really trying to expand it and grow it and give their influence even a bigger reach.
They were talking about how they're trying to turn themselves into more of a lifestyle brand. So basically making this more normal and more out there in the open,
and
getting people to wear their brand.
Yeah, as if they haven't tried tried to make sin acceptable enough. Yeah. Here they are trying to really explode it.
Yeah.
And, you know, recently Hugh Hefner passed, the founder of all this, and, you know, he died at 91 years old. The Lord was very gracious, giving him 91 years to repent. Yeah. He never did. So we know where he is now.
Yeah.
And,
sadly,
once and face judgment. But, you know, Matthew 5:28 says, you know, if you even look at a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. Yeah. And, you know, so many Americans, in fact, there's so many people all around the world, they just neglect those kinds of things. So, well, you know what? I do what I feel like doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to continue to, obviously, we need to pray for these people that are involved in these organizations and trying to do these things, because it's just so wrong. And so, again, trying to normalize sin in our culture.
We need more people astray into it.
In particular. You know, so we need to be praying for that. I mean, even within the church, you know, I saw some statistics a few years ago about men in the church, even pastors in the church that struggle with pornography.
It's huge.
And, you know, that affects their witness. It affects, you know, their family life. So we need to be praying for these guys. Yeah.
And it's kind of a warning to parents, too, to, don't just give your kid a smartphone and don't, like, you got to be careful.
Yeah,
you've
got to
make sure your kids aren't, you know, accidentally stumbling upon this kind of stuff and then getting addicted
or
and getting stuck on it.
Or even on a lot of the, I had a friend who was complaining about one of the subscription, you know, things like Netflix and things like that, where porn is very easily available even on those. And it's coming up even when you do like a general search.
Yes.
It will come up with other things. And so it's really, it can be really, you know, just innocently it's there.
I know.
And
I remember, you know, a few years ago when, you know, we had somebody come here and they were talking about some of the porn statistics and the addiction and things like that. And so I'm like, well, let me check some of this stuff, you know. And this is the mistake. You don't type in porn statistics. As soon as you put the word in the type engine, I'm like, oh, you got to be kidding me.
Never know what's going to come up.
So,
Okay, ancient human remains document migration to from Asia to America. So this was kind of a really cool find in in Alaska. They found two infants that basically they were able to get their DNA, sequence their DNA.
Really
and
cool.
That's the second oldest DNA find, or at least sequencing of a human genome in North America. So it's significant.
That's of course by their dating methods. Now, believe it or not, creationists and evolutionists would agree on something here. Mm-hmm. We would agree that, you know, a lot of Americans, a lot of Native tribes actually came over through the Bering Strait land bridge during the peak of the Ice Age when the ocean level was down and there was basically a land bridge for people to come over. Now, we would also say, though, a lot of people probably came by boat.
Right.
You see, I know some of the evolutionists are just now starting to talk about that sort of thing, but, you know, we believed that for a long time. Noah and his sons were master shipbuilders. Mm-hmm. You know, they passed that technology on. I mean, if you think of Noah, he lived 350 years after the flood. Shem lived 500 years after the flood. So they could have passed on some incredible shipbuilding technologies that people brought over. One of the things we see in the Americas is a lot of different language families. So a number of groups did come over here. This is probably just one of many. Mm. I know in here, you know, they're assuming that this might be somebody from the founding population for all the Native American tribes, but that's probably not the case. Probably for a handful
for some
of the tribes,
them,
things like that, but not necessarily all of them. When I did the book Tower Babel, one of the things that I did a lot of research on were Native Americans. And, of course, that's an area of research, believe it or not.
And there's been a lot of even what we call mitochondrial DNA evidence as well as linguistic evidence to link the Asian people groups to North and South American Indians.
Right.
And so there's no question that whether they came by boat or they came by the Bering Strait, you know,
both.
That they came
right.
from that part of the world. And even if you, if you even compare, I mean, my daughter's Chinese, if you compare her to even a lot of Native American Indians, you will see a lot of similarities
in
skin tone and eye shape. And so it's probably not really surprising that they came over and, you know, from Babel and did that and populated here.
Yeah, clearly these people were post-Babel. You know, they get their dates wrong. You know, they're throwing dates back there at 11,500 years old. That's imaginary time all of a sudden.
Right.
But, you know, it's clearly post-flood people and as they migrate to different parts of the world.
Mm-hmm. And they talked to you, the next article is ancient DNA said to support Bible's Babel account.
There's a tongue twister for you.
And so they actually had called and talked to Dr. Nathaniel Genison, who is a Harvard-trained geneticist here at Answers in Genesis. And he was saying, well, you know, like you just said, Bodhi, the imaginary time, the 11,500-year date that they give to it, that's based on evolutionary dating methods, which are based on certain assumptions about the past that aren't necessarily true. But he said genetic clocks, though, don't lie. And so basically, even the evolutionists and the creationists would agree on certain genetic clocks. And when you use those, they show that these people are only a few thousand years old, they're not millions of years old or tens of thousands of years old.
Yeah, and generally creation researchers agree on this. Mm-hmm. You know, you put it back about 4,000 years ago or just a little bit before, just a little bit after, that actually makes sense in light of the timeline. As people spread out from Babel, go to different parts of the world.
Right.
Babel, for those people in certain parts of the world. Got to say that, right? But now I did do a book, Tower of Babel, where we do look at a lot of this information. I know Dr. Jensen, you know, in his new book on replacing Darwin, you know, he deals with a lot of the genetic evidence, which is pretty neat. I look at a lot of the historical aspects and elements.
That's your thing.
That is, you know, I love that kind of stuff. You know,
if ever I have a genealogy question, I go to you.
That's right. I saw these articles. I'm like, oh, how cool is this? You know, I've got to take note of this.
It's a really cool study.
Yeah, and it is. It's neat that they were able to extract the DNA.
Yeah.
And, you know, in one sense, it kind of surprises these guys because, like, wow, look how old this DNA is, even in the evolutionary time frame.
Shouldn't be able to last that long.
And yet, there you have it. And then they turn around and then they find dinosaur DNA. And they're like, oh, wow, I can't believe that.
Yeah. Supposedly a lot older than that.
Yeah.
Well, they haven't found any intact yet. So,
that's right.
Proteins, but not DNA. Mm.
Yep.
Okay. This next one. Discovery of a clay seal from First Temple period viewed as another support of biblical text. So, you know, once again, we see archaeology confirms the Bible. So this is a 2,700-year-old clay seal, which is from the First Temple. So, time.
Yeah, this is a pretty fascinating little find here. It goes back, you know, the First Temple, just so people know, Solomon built the First Temple, and it was destroyed in the captivity. If you think of Babylon, you think of Nebuchadnezzar around that time frame. Now, initially, Israel went into captivity, I think about 700 years before Christ, and then Judah went into captivity maybe 100, 150 years later, and that's when the temple was destroyed. And, of course, the temple was rebuilt before Christ. We call that Herod's temple. It was expanded. Actually, it goes back to Zerubbabel's temple and that sort of thing, and Herod expanded it. But this is fascinating when you think about this.
Yeah, yeah.
And I like the fact that they actually presented it to the modern governor, essentially.
Yeah, it's cool, because it depicts two men wearing knee-length striped garments and has the words, the governor of the city, in Hebrew on the on the clay seal. Yeah. It's really cool.
Well, you know, there's a number of passages in the Bible that talk about, you know, governors of Jerusalem or various provinces and places like that. And, you know, we see one here in 2 Chronicles, we see one here in Kings, and they quoted that. But they actually contacted the ministry for a comment. And, you know, one of our researchers, Tim Chafee, who actually did a lot of the work on the Ark Encounter content, he does some work here at the museum as well. He's written a number of books himself. And, you know, he's actually quoted in here. And, you know, I'm going to go ahead and read what he said here. The ancient clay seal found near the western wall dates to the First Temple period and mentions the governor of the city. The Old Testament refers to the position of governor in Jerusalem at the time, a role appointed by the king. Thus, the discovery appears to be yet another in a long line of archaeological finds corroborating the accuracy and historicity of the Bible.
Yeah.
You know, we find these things
pretty
all the
neat,
time.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what we're going to continue to find, because the Bible's true. So because the Bible is true, the evidence should support and confirm that, and it does. Now, someone interesting on here said, was Noah the first ship builder? If not, why did other people not build boats to escape the flood? If he was, how was he a master shipbuilder? How do you know he was a master shipbuilder? What evidence supports that? Well, first of all, it doesn't say in the Bible that he was a master shipbuilder, but we do know that he built a massive ship.
A massive ship that survived the biggest flood in history.
I mean, we do know that from the text of Scripture, and he was given the dimensions of it, and we talk at Ark Encounter some of the ways that he might have done that and how that could have all went together, and it's possible that he had some shipbuilding experience. I mean, again, we don't have a lot of history on Noah per se, but God told him to do it, so he would have had the abilities and knowledge to do that.
Yeah, and let's say there were, you know, boats before the flood. If people hopped in those, they can survive for a little while, but they're not going to survive for an entire year over this course. We know that by the 150th day, you know, all the land-dwelling creatures, including man, were dead. So yeah. 150 days is probably the maximum anybody would have been able to make it, or animals or anything else, whether floating on driftwood, whether floating on little boats or whatever it might have been, sooner or later it's going to catch them.
Someone asked in the comments if we were in front of a live audience today. And yes, we are. You guys can clap and say hi.
Clap. Yes.
There they are.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, somebody else said, yes, there is an audience. Thank you for saying that. Yeah. Can't see them, but you can hear them.
Yeah.
All right. What Bible says about Arabian Desert? So the question is, could the Sahara Desert have been a forest just 700 years before Jesus's time? So there are some indications in scripture, like from the book of Isaiah. It talks about Isaiah chapter 21, where it talks about the forest of Arabia, and then just a short time later, I think only about 100 years or so later, we have Jeremiah talking about divine judgment and how there was a drought and that God had withheld the rain. And so, well, that's going to drastically change things, especially if it's over a 100-year period or a long period of time. And so this article kind of talks about, is what it's talking about in the Bible, is that an indication of it once having been a forest and now something very different?
Right. Well, Joseph Farah was the one who actually wrote this article. He contacted the ministry. And, I happened to have strep throat at the time, so I was sitting there at my computer. I'm like, yeah, I can comment, and I took a look at some of this. Because, I've studied some of this as well.
Right.
One of the things that we continue to find is places like the Sahara, the Arabian Desert, which is almost like an extension of it. I know it's classed as a different one. They're both huge deserts, by the way. Mm. Even Antarctica, that's actually classed as probably the biggest desert down there because of the lack of rain, even though it's really cold. But, a lot of these places, we have evidence that they were once lush, forested areas. And the Bible actually comments on the one in Arabia, being a heavily forested area. And, one of the things that he looked at, he was looking particularly at the word Ya'ar, which is translated as forest. Now, some translations, they didn't want to say forest. They want to say a thicket or desert. Because if you go there now, it's not a desert.
It is, yes. They're correcting the Bible.
What people need to understand is things have changed. After the flood, big picture, everything's wet. So things are probably fairly well watered. You're going to get initial growth and all sorts of things like that. You're going to have warm oceans because the springs of the great deep, you got the initial heat there. Any continental shifting, you're going to have heat. What that means is you're going to get more precipitation. So the world is probably going to be much more watered initially. But see, what's happening is things are changing. That's cooling off. We're moving ourselves into an ice age, which takes a lot of water out of the ocean, puts it on land, changes your ocean level, changes climates, things like that. It affects a lot of things. But then let's not forget the divine judgments. We saw that sort of thing in the days of Elijah. We also see other instances of famines and droughts and things like that, the time of Abraham, the time of Joseph, and many others. So things are actually changing. And he thinks he's kind of pinpointed, hey, this particular desert in Arabia went from being called a forest to now it's underwent judgment. Right. And it's, what happens when you don't get the rain? Well, it's going to turn into a desert.
Well, and once again, even what we're seeing in nature, we see is supported by the biblical text.
Yeah,
I mean, we have an indication of what may have happened in the past to turn it into a desert. So.
Right, we see some examples of that in the Negev as well. Right. I'm fascinated by that kind of stuff because we're in a culture today where people are like, oh, climate change, nope, what did we do? And yet, as we look
through
history,
we see
massive climate change had absolutely nothing to do with mankind. In the sense of our technological advances and things like that. Now, ultimately, all the climate change is probably because of man's sin.
Going back to Genesis
chapter 3. But then, of course, the flood, ice age, things like that. And we're still having to deal with the effects of that.
I thought it was interesting here. The author mentions how even on an evolutionary timeline, the evolutionists disagree on when changed from a lush paradise to a desert. And that's because, of course, the evidence must be interpreted. It doesn't speak for itself like so many people think it does. You have to interpret it because it's in the past.
Someone had asked on here, they ask a series of questions, and we don't have time to get into all of those, but, about human and dinosaur bones not being found in the same sediment, where did all the water go? I would highly recommend some of the articles that we have online, as well as the book, A Flood of Evidence, which is like a Q&A on the flood and the ark and stuff, and that will answer a lot of those questions that you're having.
Yeah, in fact, Answers Book 1 has a number of those, a whole answer series dives into some of that. Do you realize humans and crocodiles have never been found buried in the same rock layers either? So just because things aren't buried together doesn't mean they weren't living at the same time.
Yes.
So
Okay, thrill-seeking genes could help birds escape climate change. So this
really,
is
I thought they wanted to go on like roller coasters or something. Thrill-seeking genes.
Not this, quite the same.
A study of yellow warblers across North America, and they're trying to look at maybe what's making some more able to adapt to global warming than other birds, basically.
Climate change.
Got to throw that in. That's within an amazing number of articles that sometimes weren't even related to that, but
and all of a sudden it pops up. Like, oh, there it
is. Throw it in there all the time. So basically, this is a study. So when we were talking about these articles, we're like, well, you're the geneticist.
That's right.
You talk about them.
Yes, we're glad you're here today.
So they looked at these populations, and they found that variants of two genes, DRD1 or DRD4 and DAF1, were found, like certain variants of those genes were found in populations that were in decline versus ones that were thriving. So they think these genes may have something to do with it. So the question I thought was, well, what are these genes? What are they doing? And DRD4 is actually a dopamine receptor. And so it's involved in our behavioral response to things like alcohol, methamphetamines, cocaine. You know, it's kind of involved in that response.
What about caffeine? Is caffeine on that
list? Caffeine's not on the list.
Oh, all right.
And DAF1 has to do with, they know that mutations in it can lead to intellectual disability, a speech impairment, behavior problems. So both genes have actually been linked to psychiatric problems. Mutations in them have been linked to psychiatric problems in human beings. So my question was, are these really, I'm not sure how much they're thrill-seeking genes per se, or novelty-seeking genes. I don't really know. Like, for a bird, I'm not really sure how that applies in the first place, because they're not like human beings exactly in that sense. So it's a little hard to know. I'm not saying that their research isn't valid. I mean, obviously, there's differences that they're finding. The question is, are those differences significant, and is that what making the difference?
Right, I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, their definition of thrill-seeking is basically moving to a new place instead of staying put.
So there's usually more than one factor. There's usually multiple factors in for organisms deciding whether to migrate or not migrate or you know, do certain things.
Oh, yeah, so. I'm sure. You know, I mean, they rely on their senses as well.
Right.
You know, if something comes in, destroys their habitat, they don't have much of a choice, you know.
Got to move,
things like that are involved, I think, as well.
There's a drought. You got to...
And even birds.
Droughts. Famines.
Yeah.
Deserts.
When I was in the Galapagos, there's certain finches that can even sense when weather changes are happening, and they tend to hybridize more and form different... Two different species will come together to form what we call hybrid species. And so they can sense, they know, they're smart in that sense.
Right, and the hybrid species are more robust and able to deal with changes better.
Yeah. Okay. This next article. I shake my head. Okay. The transgender family where the father gave birth. Think about that for a minute. Okay. So, Bodhi, what did you say it was?
Okay. Let me just put this
down
into bare
basic
terminology.
Make it really easy.
A man gets a woman pregnant, and she gives birth.
Yeah,
that's really what it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's you wouldn't think that's a big deal, but of course it's now a big deal because people don't identify as what they think they are. I guess I'm going to identify as the identifier, so that's what I'm going to do here. Right. I'm going to identify who these different people are. The names of them are Diane and Fernando. Now, Diane was actually born a male, but identifies as a female. Fernando was born as a female and identifies as a male.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay. Now, here's what's interesting, and I had to write this down. If Diane, who was originally born as the guy, identifies as a woman, then why were they performing the male duties? Did you ever stop thinking about that? And vice versa. If Fernando, who was born as a girl, identifies as a man, then why was she performing the duties of a female? You know what I would suggest? I would suggest in their heart of hearts, they don't really believe what they're saying.
Well, how can they? I mean, it's just sad. It's a great perversion of things. And they were only together for like a very, this is down in Guayaquil, Ecuador, too.
Yeah,
I
should
mention that. This is, and they haven't even named this baby yet. They were only together for a few weeks before she became
They're not saying if it's a boy or a girl, are they?
No, I don't. You know, they think so. I think they just call the baby the snail all the time. So, they don't tell what the gender is.
Yeah, it's a really sad, you know, case where we see, and they have not had gender reassignment surgery, which is what makes this even possible.
You know, when I first read that, it says in their case, neither Fernando nor Diane has had gender reassignment surgery, but everybody keeps saying gender has nothing to do with physical. And if that's the case, how can you have a gender reassignment surgery then?
Right.
I mean, we got to put our thinkers on this stuff. This stuff is illogical. Well, and it's being imposed on people.
And when you think, and we've had articles before talking about how they're trying to teach this to kids. I mean, can you imagine like how confusing this would be? I mean, well, you can be whatever gender you want, you choose. I mean, wow, it's just so confusing.
Well,
it's
what is it? Facebook now has over 50 different genders.
Oh,
And there's people saying there's more, there's less. Yeah. There's none. There's some people saying, I mean, it's purely
asexual.
Arbitrary. You know, God says there's two. There's male, there's female. Now, of course, in a sin cursed and broken world, you know, we do run into mutations and things like that that have caused developmental issues and things like that. But, you know, that's the way God defines it.
Yeah. And I mean, in a sin cursed world, there's going to be people who struggle with this issue of gender and stuff. Yeah. And they deserve, obviously, compassion and love, but also the truth, which comes from God's word and not from our culture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody said on here, I tried to identify as a 55-plus-year-old at Denny's last night, and they told me I can't do that.
Good try.
And so, that's the thing. I mean, you take it to its extreme. If I want to identify as a senior, why can't I get senior discounts? I mean, you know, if that's who I think I really am.
That tried to give me the senior discount there not too long ago. They're like, you're over 50, right? And I'm like,
gosh, that's sad. Okay.
Boy. Someone here wants to know how I feel about Ken getting blamed for the article that I wrote with him. I love it when he gets in trouble and I don't get in trouble. It's great. Yeah. I'm not going to complain about that.
I always tell Ken that's part of being the boss.
Yeah,
right. You know,
he gets blamed for everything. Like, I've even written articles just on my own that have my name on them, and then he posts them on his Facebook, and he gets in trouble for them, and he didn't have anything to do with it.
Yeah, I've written stuff where Ken got the blame. And
it's great.
It's always happened. Yeah. It always happens.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for Ken to write something and I get the blame.
So this leads into our next, sort of article. And someone actually had given me this over Christmas break, sadly, and said, you know, just wanted me to take a look at it. And it's called the gingerbread person, not gingerbread, but gingerbread. And it's on a website called itspronouncedmetrosexual.com. And basically it's trying to go through all these different aspects of gender. So you have gender identity, gender expression, biological sex, and then who you're attracted to sexually and romantically. And trying to show the, like we said, there's 50 different genders on Facebook. They're trying to show the spectrum, so to speak, that there is. And it blows me away. Like, especially when it comes to biological sex, there isn't a spectrum. Now there are rare cases where there is ambiguity because of developmental or genetic problems, and we're not, and those are sad situations.
Very sad.
We're not discounting
but very
that.
Rare.
But with it, there is no spectrum other than that. You're either male or you're female. That's it. I mean, when it comes to biological sex, and then they're trying to separate sex from gender. See, that's the other problem. There is no separation.
And they do that arbitrarily. You know, here just as a philosophical question, let's say a person is born male. How do they actually know the mind of a female to say that they identify as female?
Good question.
Yeah.
And vice versa, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, from a philosophical perspective, that is impossible. Mm-hmm. Unless you have mind transfer, which, sorry,
that
hasn't happened yet.
But yeah, it's really sad as I even read through sort of the article on this. It said labels have always been one of the toughest parts of the genderbred person. And I'm like, yeah, because you're trying to label something that isn't even real. I mean, your gender identity, which is what basically you think you are in your mind, your gender expression, what you actually look like on the outside. So
like
I'm guessing
how you portray yourself.
Yeah. So you could think you're a woman in your identity, but dress like a man as part of your expression. I mean, because again, it's mix and match. It's basically whatever you want.
Well, notice they have a book here, A Guide to Gender, which is on its second edition. And yet there's a lot of people who probably disagree with a massive number of this. Like we said, you know, on Facebook, people have 35 different types of definition of, different ideas about gender and so forth. It becomes so convoluted that it's meaningless.
My thought on it was basically just, this is so confusing. But when we go to God's word, we don't find that confusion. No. We find Genesis 1:27, God created male and female.
Yeah. Well, and even says, you know, it talks in here about they're trying to have an honest depiction of how people experience gender. Gender is not an experience. Gender is a fact. And so that's, you know, that's the problem with it. Okay, so we're gonna skip to the last article because we only have a few minutes left, and these next two articles are really tied together. So we're gonna skip to the last one and talk about a worm species that supposedly lost 7,000 genes after evolving to fertilize itself.
Boy, they had to just throw evolve in there.
Yeah, they did. Nothing to do with it.
You know, this worm never really changed into like a cow. You know, so it's not really evolution.
No, that's the thing. I mean, losing something doesn't make an organism evolve from one kind to another kind.
Yeah.
And these 7,000 genes is what, like, I think they said a quarter of the genome.
It's a lot.
It's a massive amount.
Yeah, it's a massive. So this is the, this organism is Caenorhabditis, which is a type of roundworm. It's a nematode. They're very small. They're only like a millimeter in length. They're transparent. And they've been studied extensively. And so they're a model organism, so to speak, for the genetics labs at least. And they're comparing different species. So this species, Brixiae, can self-fertilize. It's a hermaphrodite, so it doesn't need, it still has sperm and eggs, but it doesn't need a sexual partner, and it's become completely that
way. Think about flower. You know, a lot of flowers are self-pollinating where they have both parts, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Kind of an easy way to think about it.
So they were comparing ones that are completely self-fertilizing with ones that are not. There are certain species that only have sexual reproduction, and so they compared them, and that's how they know that the Brixiae species lost 7,000 genes. So the question is, what were those genes doing?
Well, how many have they lost before all this? I mean, it makes you wonder all that stuff.
Yeah.
One of the things the article says here, 1 million years ago, a species of tiny worms evolved the ability to breed via self-link. How do they know that? Were they there?
No.
I mean, nobody observed that sort of thing. That's just a conjecture that they're throwing in there.
Yeah. Right. And that's the thing. It's always, the time is always off. Now, the question is this something that they truly did lose, you know, the adaptation maybe over time? Again, it's not evolution. Or is it just created genetic diversity? I mean, these are not, Noah's not taking two of these on the ark, okay?
That's
They're going to survive. They're going to make it. So there could have been a lot of just created genetic diversity that God gave these organisms originally. Or it could be that they've adapted and lost it, but it's still not an example of evolution.
Yeah. It's going in the opposite
direction. And becoming something else. It's still a nematode. It hasn't changed at all.
You know, I hate it when I lose one pair of genes, let alone
7,000.
I think we deserve that chocolate after hearing that.
Well, they don't, you know, they don't know why they lost the genes. Yeah. But again, they're having to replicate very quickly. That's an advantage. So if you can jettison that DNA, get rid of it, it takes less time. And 1/4 of your genome is significant.
Yeah.
So you can replicate
the
DNA faster. You can replicate the organisms faster. So it would be an advantage.
And I think they said some of those genes control the competitiveness of sperm. And obviously self-fertilizing, that doesn't matter. So they don't need those.
Yeah. So okay, well, that's all we have time for today.
We will be back Monday.
I got to read this. This says, thank you, Bodie Hodge. Exactly. A man could never know the mind of a woman well enough to think himself one. All right. So we're gonna sign off today and come back Monday because we're going to be talking about a very interesting article entitled, Is Your Child Lying to You? That's Good. So you'll want to come back Monday and hear more about that. And so we'll all three be back on Monday, I guess.
Yep.
Three of us again.
We'll be outnumbering you again. Better bring more chocolate.
I'm gonna have to bring more chocolate.
And someone on here asked if we do this regularly. It's every Monday and Thursday at 2 p.m.
2 o'clock. And they can see the archives on our YouTube channel. Answers in Genesis.
And on Ken Ham's Facebook page.
So
all right. So we're signing off and we'll see you back on Monday.
God bless you guys.